From Zapper, this is the state of AR.
All right. Well, look, afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the State of AR episode 8. So this week we are going to be talking about how to approach design in AR. Well, look, it comes at the end. We go Wednesday to Wednesdays now. So another jam-packed week. And another new prime minister. You know, I think this is a new segment we're going to add to our show. Just who's prime minister this week? I mean, it's kind of got so bad that actually a few days ago, I was literally competing in a Zoom call with a potential new Italian partner that we're working in about whose political crisis was worse. I mean, that's, you don't talk about the weather. You know, in the States used to be about how did you get to work. Now we're just like, yeah, well, our economy is worse than yours. In fact, our political class is terrible. What's yours like? No, ours is. How many prime ministers have you had? Oh, quite a lot too. Okay. It's hopefully calming down now. Now, as I said last week, we are kind of mixing it up a little here on the show. What we're going to do from now on in, I mean, Dave has this scheduled till about 2028. So there's a lot of more shows to get through, is to invite sort of esteemed Zappa guests from across the business to join us. And really, I guess, part of that mission of shining a spotlight on the everyday reality and how we augment it effectively. So on this episode, I am delighted to welcome none other than the wonderful Anna Broadhurst to the show. And Anna is just an unbelievably talented senior designer here at Zappar and illustrator. And also, I should say, one of the most understated individuals you're likely to meet. But just don't be fooled by her quiet demeanor. She is like Hong Kong phooey when it comes to design and illustration. And we've had the honor of having Anna with us at Zappa for coming up to 10 years. It's actually 9 years and 10 months. So really, really quite close now. So almost since we started the company. And I guess her work across that decade has just been consistently of the highest quality and really delivering that kind of Zappa magic dust to every project that she's involved in. In fact, I think she invented the idea of Zappa magic dust and in many ways has kind of helped establish the tone and look and feel of Zappa as we've grown as a brand. And not only that, she's also gone on to publish her own AR children's books and work on projects outside of Zappa for the likes of Adidas. And indeed also sells her own original artwork online, some of which I have proudly hung down at my flat on the Isle of Wight. So thank you, Anna, for those. They look lovely. And welcome to the show. I hope you received your State of AR mug.
I did. All in one piece came in the post. Thank you very much.
I was saying to Anna, I did sort of slack her this morning, and I was like, oh, did it arrive? Because when I went to the post office, you know, I thought I'd packaged it quite well, but you know, I gave it to them, and the way that it was casually thrown, yeah, like right into the back,
I
was like, okay, well, that's not turning up in one piece. But it did.
It did, yes. And thank you for that lovely intro. That was really nice. It's nice to be here.
You're worth it. and I guess before we get into today's topic then, you know, we're just gonna do our usual section of kind of, I guess, what's inspired us creatively, you know, what we've been listening to, what's been going on around. And I got to say, for me this week, the new album of choice that just got stuck on my record player was a guy called Loyal Kana and his album Hugo. Now Loyal is a British Guyanese rapper who I guess is again not afraid of tackling pretty difficult subjects, you know, about race and identity and indeed parenthood. You know, he is indeed a parent himself, and I sort of describe this album as a sort of relatable self-interrogation, if you like. And it struck a chord with me, as these always do, because it is that sort of trip back to some old school hip hop and some jazz undertones, which is clearly my happy place. But I think what's also special to me about this artist is that I was actually given one of his earlier albums, which is called Not Waving But Drowning, on vinyl by my son for Christmas a year ago. And I think that's quite a special moment as well, when your musical tastes overlap with your kids. And so I guess Laurel has that slightly special place in my collection because of it. I don't know if my son's listened to this yet, but I think he's going to like it. Anna, what have you been listening to? What have you been up to this week?
So on that, on fun fact on the Loyal Kana, he is actually really good friends with an old Zappar employee. If you remember the wonderful Adam Javes,
he worked
as a producer at Zappar a few years back. And Adam actually got engaged to his girlfriend Ellie on the pyramid stage at Glastonbury during Loyal Kana's set. So they had a pact. So Adam said, if you can get me free, me and Ellie free tickets to Glastonbury this year, I'll propose to her. And yeah, so there's a video out there of him introducing his good friend Adam.
Good.
I know, and yeah, true to his word, he got down on one knee, and yeah, luckily she said, yeah. Well, that would be really awkward.
That is absolutely brilliant. Do you know what? Actually, funny enough, it's Adam who sort of inspired me to get back into vinyl, because I really remember him being at the office, and he got an Arctic Monkeys album. I forget which one it was that had turned up, and I saw him sort of taking it home, and he was so excited about taking it home and listening to it. And I was like, that's cool. God, I'd sort of forgotten that sort of magic of it. That's a brilliant story. I love that.
So I've recently discovered a series of podcasts actually by the illustration agency called Handsome Frank, who some of their illustrators are kind of who I idolized on their books. They're really great. And they've done a series where they're just kind of talking to each illustrator in turn and kind of about their process and what they've been working on. So yes, I think I'm halfway through. I think there's about 8 of them. So I'm going through those. So they've been really good for any illustration geeks out there.
I'm always intrigued by podcasts and when people kind of find the time to listen to them. Because I guess I naturally just go put music on in the background. But is there a time that do you just like having on the background? Is it sort of
I find it depends what I'm working on. If I'm animating something, because with animation, it's such a long process. And actually, you know, you can almost do it subconsciously when you're doing the nitty gritty bit. An ambulance going by. It's a really good time to actually listen to like a full audiobook or a podcast. Whereas if I'm trying to come up with ideas and concepts, I tend to listen to music. So
Makes sense.
This has been an animation week, so hence the podcast.
Love that. Okay, well, I guess then on to other news items. And I guess there was a great opinion piece in one of the Sunday supplements, and I forget which one, which was on Facebook. I mean, I guess there's lots of op-eds around Facebook at the moment and all the challenges they face at the moment with, you know, sort of tanking share price, challenges with their ad business, sort of congressional hearings, whistleblowers, dirty tricks with lobbying, the competition from TikTok, obviously, and indeed other sort of competition commission reviews around sort of any new acquisitions they can make. And then criticism about their investment in the metaverse. And I think actually their quarterly results come out today. And I have to say there's one point where I go, I don't know Mark Zuckerberg, but I really feel for him. I mean, I just wouldn't want to wake up to his email every morning. There was a wonderful piece in there where he goes, you know, he's obviously taken up sort of martial arts or kickboxing or some sort of really brutal fighting that obviously gets him through the day now, which I kind of understand. You know, and I know there are loads of detractors. I know there's lots of things that they don't do particularly well. But at the same time, you know, some credit has to be due to building a business that touches 3.5 billion people's lives on a daily basis. And I guess, you know, putting his head properly above the parapet to try and invest in Web3 and the future of spatial computing. Now, whether you like his version of where it's heading or not, the fact that he is kind of investing in the way that he is, certainly I applaud. Clearly the markets aren't quite so sure. And I guess there is that thing that with so much power does come an inordinate amount of responsibility. And perhaps that is just too much for one man or one business. I mean, discuss, that's an entire different show, I suspect. But I think the other challenge, of course, is that with every generation that comes a sort of a new cohort who really don't want to follow in the footsteps of their predecessors and will happily congregate around their own tech solution and favored algorithm. And in fact, the further away it is from your parents being able to see it, the better. And I guess, you know, that comes to TikTok, which has become this kind of very real threat, I guess, to Facebook as younger audiences spend less time on Instagram and more on TikTok. And I think it's sort of therefore inevitable and perhaps why Mark's chosen to look forward sort of into that kind of blue ocean of kind of the next 10 years around virtual worlds, knowing that the core business is going to continue to throw off a lot of money. Okay, maybe the ad business is depressed a bit, all the rest of it. It's still large, you know, billions and billions of dollars a quarter, while he focuses on, I guess, creating the next computing age. I mean, I don't know. I find this a tricky one because I'm not really on social media. I do a bit of LinkedIn, but I'm not really on anything else. I mean, I don't know. Anna, are you on Instagram or Facebook or any of these things?
I used to be. I'm still on Facebook, but I have to say over the last 3 years or so, I haven't got the app on my phone anymore, and I just never. I probably should log on. There's probably all sorts of messages on there, but yeah, I just don't use it. But I do use Instagram, and I use that in a kind of professional capacity, really. So I don't post pictures of me. I post my work, and so it's mainly promoting me as an illustrator rather than me as a person. Although I do use kind of we've got the stories at the top, but it's mainly photos of my dog, which,
the other reason for the internet, let's be honest. But I think it's really interesting because Instagram is definitely a place where I guess designers and illustrators and sort of producers and the fashion industry congregate, and I guess Twitter very much for sort of journalists and politicians and crazy people, but I think it is interesting how those, they're used for different things, aren't they? I mean, I guess I know there's an ill-fated attempt to try and turn Instagram into TikTok, which everyone sort of riled against instantly.
Yeah, I have to say they do seem to be managing to do that. They've kind of added this reel section, and you do find yourself kind of in a rabbit hole of dog videos, and which I kind of think, well, I just won't look at that bit, but then you end up finding yourself there again, and it is a bit kind of
there's something about dogs and cats, isn't there? I mean, it's where all the money is.
After a few too many drinks the other day, I followed a load of hedgehog accounts. And if you've never seen a hedgehog eat a carrot whilst lying on its back, it is adorable. But once you follow one hedgehog, you then you get a load more. So I was a bit confused the next day when I logged on and thought, why is it all hedgehogs?
That's all you've got. That's all you've got.
They are cute.
That's brilliant. I love that. well, look, there's one final thing before we get on to today's topic, which is I do tend to always kind of have one rant that I just need to get off my chest, and once it was Derek, our beloved printer here. Actually, I have to say, since then Derek's been great. I think we workshopped and got through our issue, but my today's rant is, we talk all about how amazing the metaverse is going to be and the interoperability of all these different things. And we're going to seamlessly glide as, our digital twins from one to the other. And it's just all going to work so smoothly. If that is the case, why, oh, why is it not possible to get your sound to work on different video conferencing services in the space of just a single day? What is it that means that when I go from Zoom to Teams, that I can be heard on one and not heard on the other? I just sort of go, if we can't work these simple little things out, how are we ever going to get there? So that's it. Good.
Totally
just sound, just sound. I mean, honestly, it's not even the, you're on mute. It's the, and the sort of, now I've got to reboot, come back 10 minutes later, call's over. It's just, anyway, just had to get that off my chest. I'm sure. I think sometimes just saying it out loud will maybe make things better. So today's topic then, Anna, designing in AR. And I think it's always a good place to start, which is actually just about how you got interested as a designer in AR in the first place. And can you tell us just a bit about that journey and how you got into the industry? Because I think that sort of helps set up kind of...
So I actually came across it when I was studying for a master's degree in graphic design. And this was, 12 years ago. So AR wasn't really, I hadn't heard of it at that point. But I was obsessed, in one of my projects, obsessed with the idea of QR codes and this idea that you could digitally interact with a piece of print material. But I wanted to do it in a kind of a more visual way. So basically I was trying to invent AR from scratch. And then once I did my research and realized that it already existed. And actually Zappar were the first company I kind of came across when doing research. And I still remember that kind of, I can't remember the phrase we use when people first see AR in action. It's kind of that, just that wow of what is it. I can still remember exactly where I was and what I was doing. And I think it was the bunny mail experience. I must have been scanning my screen rather than, I didn't have any print material. So this bunny popped out and I just thought, this is amazing. And I wanted to show someone, but I was in my tiny studio flat on my fold out sofa bed and there wasn't anyone to show. So I basically really wanted to use AR for my final project, but it was 12 years ago. So there wasn't ZapWorks or, the software available to use it. So I ended up doing a project using QR codes, and you kind of scanned it and it linked to a 2D animation. And it's all kind of elusive. I had these hand-drawn fish. I've got a bit of print material for anyone that can see that. I actually drew like a QR code onto their scales, and then there was it linked to this campaign about overfishing in the seas, and there was this big installation, like a conceptual installation. So I ended up doing that. But then after I finished, so I was working part-time as a graphic designer at that point. And once the course finished, I was looking for full-time work. And I actually got a call from a recruitment agency saying, oh, we've got this this role. It's a small startup company called Zappar. And I was like, oh, oh yeah. And he was like, would you like to interview? Yes, yes, please. And so I think it was the next day I went, it was all quite quick. So I went down and interviewed and yeah, got the job. And yeah, brilliant. It's meant to be.
It really is. It's such great serendipity, that, isn't it? I love that story. It's brilliant. and I guess then, you know, how have you seen the industry and the tech change over that period? And I guess, how has that sort of affected your approach to AR, you know, over that time frame?
So obviously 10 years in this industry is quite a long time. So I've seen quite a lot of change. But I think probably the biggest change at the beginning was kind of the process that we were working through, because it was all hand coded. So when I started, I had to learn code and, you know, hand code animation, which for any designers listening, you'll understand it doesn't exactly come naturally, because we work in quite a visual way. So it was a bit of a shock to the system. And I was very, very happy when Zappar Studio came about. Thank you, Connell. So then I could work in with an interface that I was more used to, so with timelines and all of that. So that was probably the biggest change at first. And then probably more recently, it's been web AR. So it's this transition of, it was quite hard at the beginning to do the real world call to action, which is to convince someone to go to all the effort of downloading an app and then scanning this. So AR in a way has made things so much more accessible, because we don't have to convince them. We just say, everyone knows what to do with a QR code now. So just point your phone and then the experience happens in the browser. So it's a lot easier. It has meant that it's kind of, I found we've moved away from kind of tracking to images and using like real world objects as kind of the triggers. It's more kind of, we can just use world tracking and pop something up in the environment without from a QR code, which has changed. I do miss the images sometimes.
I'm with you on that. I mean, I think things that are world tracked can be lovely, but there's something about the interplay between physical and digital and that sort of transition that is just so it's so magical and kind of delightful. And it sort of has that effect of you sort of looking beyond your phone to see if what you're seeing is really happening or not. And I think that sort of connection, you're right, is, you know, I know there are portals and other ways of trying to do things, but there is something, just maybe it's very purist in a way, but, you know, be able to do that off packaging or off murals or some of these other things. So, it's a beautiful thing. And well, it probably leads to the next question, which I was going to ask, sort of what AR experiences are you drawn towards? But is that sort of...
Yeah, so it's definitely kind of bringing images and, in my world, bringing an illustration to life, just because it combines what I love, which is illustration and animation. So the idea of having this printed image or whatever in the real world, that when you scan, the kind of the start frame of the whole experience is that image. So you get to see it transform. And just, I actually was thinking back to some of the projects we did just for Zappar, and there was, do you remember that genie? We did a little genie sticker. I had to illustrate a little genie lamp on it. Yeah. And then there was like a zap code in the background, and you're prompted to scan it to release the genie. And so you had this fun little rubbing animation with a squeaky sound effect, and out pops either you or one of the other founders as little, dressed as a genie, as little cartoon. And it was just great. And then you granted their wish of, I think it was a free trial to called Zap Code Creator at that point. But it was because it just made sense. It was like, everyone knows when they look at a genie lamp, they know that you know, they're meant to rub it and out pop. So it was just kind of really fun way. It wasn't my idea. I'm not claiming that. I don't know whose idea it was.
Yeah.
I was just told to do it.
I remember that now. I'd totally forgotten that.
I know. I wish I could, I don't have one. I wish I had a sticker, but I couldn't find
it. No, and you could tell that it was someone who also, which was brilliant, was just like, this is the perfect way as well to really send up the founders, because I seem to remember then the animations, the 2D animations were then of us sort of dancing at the end of it, but kind of
really,
you know,
it just looked absolutely absurd.
I remember that. Well, I was also gonna say, I mean, I do obviously have brought props here, but that reminded me of these two beauties that you did, which was this tiny little and all beautifully illustrated, the little book of zaps, which indeed, you know, did bring kind of these little characters to life. And there was one with a butterfly. There was a little car that came sort of to life, wasn't there? And I can't remember what that one did. And indeed, our kind of little bird, etc. But all sort of beautifully, beautifully illustrated and brought together. These are wonderful. And it seems that we've kind of went, in order to go bigger, it has to be bigger. So that transitioned into kind of the adventure suit, which again is another beautiful, sort of beautifully illustrated piece by Anna, and also sort of kind of written with Simon, because he loves a writing challenge. But this was great. It was like, you know, a really lovely little narrative about a boy who, you know, a bit bored in his bedroom and brings sort of cardboard boxes to life and goes on this sort of little adventure. That then, you know, again, that wonderful connection between, I guess, what you see on the page, so you don't have to, you could still enjoy the book without AR, but kind of AR adds that other layer.
In the pages, he's in his bedroom wearing a like a cardboard box with the suit, and so only when you actually scan it do you get to see him in his, you know, the real life little adventure world. Which
that's it.
Yeah,
and I guess that then led to the boy with the head stuck in a book, which was your own kind of published piece that you did. I forget the name of your lovely friend. Oh yeah, Frankie.
Frankie,
who wrote and you illustrated and brought it to life. Do you want to tell us a bit about that? Because it's a lovely.
Yeah. So that was as you mentioned. So it was written. So my friend Frankie O'Reilly is an old school friend. She wrote. So Dave's kindly shown this as the promotional video that we did for it. But she wrote the story, and she's actually a teacher. She works as a teacher, but is also a talented writer. But at the time, a few years ago, she had a class where she had a group of boys, about 8 to 9 year olds, who just were not interested in reading, and she just couldn't get them to read. But anything on an iPad, they were just glued to. So we decided together to try and create this aimed at that age range, a book that combines both. So it's the story of, it's got the very catchy title of The Boy With His Head Stuck in a Book, which is quite a mouthful, but it's a young boy who becomes bored with reading, but when he gets his head trapped in a magical book, he is taken on a series of adventures. So it's got a traditional written story inside of it, but then there's 10 illustrations inside that when you scan, you get to see actually his little head going on this journey inside of each of the different magical worlds. So each page kind of followed a template where there was like a hole looking inside the book. And so I created, so it was like a little, it was all 2D graphics, but it was all like a little parallax world inside of the book. So then I could animate and do everything myself. So it was all animated and made in studio. And there is interaction, so you can kind of tap to interact with the animations. So again, it was, you know, something I put together completely. So it's really fun. And we managed to get a very small publisher to publish it up in Newcastle, where Frankie works and where I grew up. So called Time Bridge Publishing. So they kindly got on board with us. And we did a great event at the Newcastle Library when we launched it, and we had a load of kids came, and we did a reading and showed them the book in action. And we also did, we had a great big printout of the cover, and we did it so you took a picture of each kid and then you pointed it at the cover, and there it would be their head that was stuck in the book, and that went down really well. They loved that. So it was really good just seeing actually a bunch of kids using it, which, you know, when you're designing it for so long, it's kind of, you don't think about that. And then it was a lot of work. There was a lot of animation in there, but it was really fun.
But I think one of the other really important things about two things about that that I think are fascinating is one, you obviously was thinking about AR right from the start, you know, so it's how can this not be the afterthought that we're sort of just trying to shoehorn into the way that this story and this narrative sort of unfolds. And I guess the other thing was, as you mentioned, sort of creating those almost templates in terms of, you know, how were you going to make sure that you weren't giving yourself a kind of a design and budget challenge of, oh my God, now I've got to make all of these and each one's different and this can take me forever and it's going to cost a fortune. I think sort of playing with how do you create that sort of framework in order to for it to feel different each time, but presumably around sort of some knowns.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting, isn't it? Because we've talked with lots of different publishers over the years about lots of really interesting projects, but it's always been that thing of either not quite at the start of the project or, you know, trying to figure out then where it fits. And, you know, always everything in publishing is pretty budget constrained, to be honest.
Yeah, exactly.
So, but it's a beautiful thing. I guess that leads on to kind of, you know, what your creative process generally is, you know, when you get a brief, you know, where do you start?
So it depends. So with Zappar, we tend to get two types of briefs. There's one that's quite specific. So it'll be the client's like, we want this AR experience and it needs to be like this. And so it's kind of a quicker process to do those ones. But for the ones that are quite open, that it tends to be, so obviously you start off reading through the brief and becoming familiar with any like brand guidelines that the client sends over, or you have to research any topics that you don't fully understand, or if it's a product, you need to learn how it works and everything. So you do that. And then the key part is you ask the client questions, because it's rare that the initial brief actually contains all of the information you need. So don't be scared to kind of say, you know, just ask questions. So then after that, start coming up with concepts, and these can just be written ideas or, you know, a full deck with visuals, depending on if the client's paying, you know, depends on what their budget is at that stage, if they're paying for that part of it. So then present those concepts to the client. And once the final concept is approved, I then do like a user experience flow. So it just shows the client exactly what, you know, the journey that the user will be going on, and that's sent to the client. They approve or don't approve, and you do some amends. So then I work on the interface design. So it's designing actually how the whole thing looks. And at that stage, any storyboards that we need, if it's an animation heavy project, I'll do that stage. And again, that's sent back to the client for approval. And then the next stage is either I do the animations myself and send kind of call them sub symbols out. So I do use Studio and actually create the animations and then send them on to the developer. And I export all the graphics that the developer will then need, along with all the visuals, so they can then they piece it all, they do the magic bit and piece it all together so that it actually works. So that tends to be kind of the generalized process.
I found that there's one sort of insidious small word in the English language that turns out is the easiest to say but the most expensive to use, which is the word just. And I find it true in illustration animation, where, you know, quite far down the line someone goes, can you just change the, you know, the just the animate, just the head, can you just change the head of that? And you kind of, you know, and maybe it's because there's too much stuff online that just goes, here's this software that means you can just instantly make this thing different and boom, bow, down, it's done. And it's just not like that, is it? It's actually you know, some of those things said at the wrong time of the in the process can be incredibly awkward.
That's why storyboards are key, and it's kind of, you know, saying to the client, you've signed this off now, this is how we're going to animate, you know, it's an important step of it.
And I guess it's quite a collaborative process as well. Obviously, as you mentioned, sort of handing off with developers, and there might be sort of 3D elements to it, or and producers and other people. You know, what's the key to sort of collaboration there, both between kind of, I guess, clients and internal, you know, staff?
So like the producer is the one that starts the process and puts together the team. And during kind of the briefing session for the initial start of the project, we'll bring in the developer and the 3D artist, and whoever the designer is, will all be involved in that stage, so they can kind of be a part of that initial initial discussions. And then once the design process starts, I, like I said, I do the user experience and the UI and any storyboards. And again, then the 3D artist and developer have another, they're able to review that again before that gets sent to the client. So they can kind of say that's an impossible thing to do in 3D or whatever. So then it goes to the 3D artist and they build any models and animations. And I would, like I said, export the graphics or create any 2D animations need. And then again, it's the developer that then receives all of that and then plugs it all together.
Yeah, there's a lot of different things going on at the same time, aren't there, that sort of have to
It depends on the project. I mean, sometimes it's not 3D heavy, so we don't actually need a 3D design, or sometimes it's really 3D heavy, so that they'll take on kind of the storyboarding and the design of that part, and the designer just does kind of the UI. So yeah.
You just said just.
Oh, sorry.
I guess what would you say to any sort of designer then thinking about creating their own AR experience, and you know, kind of what are the opportunities and challenges of working in, I guess, spatial sort of computing?
It's probably the biggest thing is learning to think in a three-dimensional way rather than a 2D one. I mean, most designers are used to having the screen as a constraint, really, and it does take a while to kind of get your head around not having that. But then when you do, it kind of, you have there's so many more opportunities, you have so much more freedom. So then, you know, there's plenty more opportunities than there is kind of challenges, I guess.
Yeah, no, you're right. Because it is interesting. I always find that there's a point, that's true more of ZapWorks, and I guess to our community that's using it, is that it almost feels like there's so much opportunity. It's very hard to know where to start, you know, because it's almost like I could do everything and you end up sort of doing nothing. But I think it's true of some of the stuff in the books that you've done. It's amazing how actually small things can have quite a dramatic effect. It doesn't have to be, you know, this huge kind of, you know, over the top, you know, sort of 3D affair. It can be just some lovely little moments, you know, with a bit of parallax effect, and you know, that sometimes are I think just as engaging and interactive, and we see work just as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
This might sound like a negative one, but I guess what's your sort of biggest gripe about working with sort of spatial computing, and is there anything that you sort of wish there was kind of this magic fix for? It's just like, oh god, it would just be so much easier if.
it's probably the amount of, literally the amount of things you have to think about when designing. So, and it's mainly the bits that you don't have any control over. So like the lighting of wherever the experience is going to be, or kind of the internet, the Wi-Fi connection, where is it located? Is it in a busy situation? All of these things that are quite, you know, there's a lot to think about that you have to kind of consider right at the beginning of a project, which, you know, because I don't have any control over it, it is kind of like you're at the mercy of the client to kind of let you know or decide the right thing really for each experience.
Well, it's that one, and also, yeah, that's a good one. It reminds what you said earlier about that sort of call to action piece as well. Of, you know, if you can't tell people, I mean, I guess we're sort of getting it back into our five C's, which I'm glad that it's being validated by yourself. and maybe going in a completely different direction then. You know, what would be, you know, your one, and there might be more, you know, sort of ask of a client, you know, when putting together an AR brief to work on? You know, you sort of said, oh, there's all sometimes questions to go back with. What are the ones that are really, you know, are most important from your perspective?
To be honest, it probably is the ones that I've just mentioned. They're the things that really do need to be thought about. And you know, sometimes I'd make a terrible salesperson, because sometimes you do think, does this really need AR? Like, why is AR going into this project? You know, it's a hectic environment. It's, you know, it's just all kind of wrong. So you think, although it's kind of can be a fun and really exciting thing, you need a reason to be doing it. And as a designer, it's like, if you ever get a brief where it's just kind of like, we just want like an amazing experience that gives the wow factor, that there's nothing to it. It's kind of, you know, you really want a solid brief, like in any design project, but across any medium.
Yeah, it's a great answer. I mean, it is that thing, is that you need that either problem or opportunity statement, don't you? You need that thing of this is why we're doing it, and this is why AR is relevant. And if it's not, absolutely do something else. And as you say, it's then where and what are all the reasons it's going to go wrong, isn't it?
Yeah.
And then you can kind of figure out what's right about it. And so, you know, it's obviously been a long time since you started your career, as we found out. But what would you say to anyone who's starting now? You know, is there anything, I guess, that you wish you'd known before getting involved, or indeed knowing the state of it now? You know, how would you sort of coach someone to present themselves to get into the industry?
I'd probably say don't be intimidated by it. It's not, you know, there are extra things you have to think about, but it follows exactly the same design principles that, like I said before, across any other medium. So there's just a few additional things that you kind of have to think about. But as mentioned before, it means that you have quite a lot more freedom in designing stuff. So it is worthwhile. But yeah, there is a certain like kind of point at the beginning where you have to get your head around a lot of stuff. But yeah, just don't be intimidated by that, really.
Yeah.
And you won't all have to hand code animation when you begin.
those days are over. Yeah. I guess just to finish with, before we sort of open it up to the floor, I mean, are there any other kind of, I guess, recent or future projects that you're excited about, and, you know, you can talk about without giving anything away?
So for the last God knows how long, it feels like it's been forever, I've been working on this project for H&M, which for their kids stores. So it's kind of a in-store experiences using these fun characters all based around their sustainability pact and range. And so they've got these wooden characters in store, actual physical characters, but then we've got QR codes kind of dotted about, and they actually have these recycling bin, physical recycling bin monsters, which have big eyes and a mouth where you go and put in your clothes. So we've come up with a really fun game where you have to scan them, the characters all come to life and animate, and then you have to, the kids, it's aimed at quite young kids, so they have to find the pieces of items on that each of the characters are wearing, like a scarf or a hat, and they have to tap them, and then it gets swallowed up by the recycling bin monster. So it's been a really fun project, and quite a lot of animation and fun characters. So yeah, it'd be great to see it in action. Yeah.
What's great as well is it's sort of because they almost didn't, there's no backstory, is there, to those characters, and they don't, you know, they are beautiful illustrations, but that point where you have to then animate them and kind of give them a personality becomes quite an interesting thing, isn't it? Because, you know, what is the character of a raindrop?
luckily because they were actually wooden characters, you could kind of get away with making them quite wooden. So they didn't have to have a load of flowing movement, which is always a lot harder with animation.
They did sort of feel as if they were definitely in your I have to say, when that brief came in, it was like, I think Anna needs to work on this one. This looks very similar to this one.
Definitely, really excited
to see that come out. Great. Well, I mean, I've obviously been lucky enough to ask all the questions. Has anybody else got any other questions, Dave? Have we got any questions that come in, or anyone on here who'd like to pose a design-related AR question?
We do, I got a couple of questions in advance. One which has been a bit of a consistent theme for us, which is around accessibility. Do you have any pointers for designing with accessibility in mind?
That is quite a challenge. I do remember it coming up in some projects, but it's, well, because it is so, AR is quite complicated in itself. It is kind of hard to make it fully accessible, but, you know, it would definitely be considered where possible, you know, if it needed, like we always have subtitles on for audio and, you know, I guess we could do it the other way around, where you could have an audio description of an experience. But yeah, it's definitely, we could definitely explore that more, I'd say.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's funny. It does come up a lot, which like, and I keep saying it's a good thing.
Yeah.
And we've got, I'm going to talk about it in a minute, but we've also got our Pioneers session come up in a couple of weeks, and we're being joined by the Royal National Institute of the Blind, who we're working with quite a bit more, both on some projects, but actually really trying to understand how we can influence and create some sort of common standards for how accessibility could work in an XR context, which is really, you know, that, you know, you have to think of that just from a tech stack perspective as much as a design perspective as to what is achievable, especially in web AR, you know, because there's certain things that you can do in browsers, but when you add on to that, you know, sort of the camera protocols, etc., you know, there's some things that are easier to get at than others. So it's definitely a really interesting area. It seems to be the most important one there is you have to start right at the beginning. Cannot be something that isn't afterthought. It has to be, you know, almost at the point you're starting thinking about what this experience might look like. And I think it's a really interesting point in speaking to the guys at R&IB about it, where they also go, you know, you have to make sure that whatever you're coming up with isn't then just a crappy experience for everyone. You know, it's more going back to what is the problem statement and the thing that you are trying to achieve. And actually, you know, almost to Anna's point, if you're trying to do accessibility in AR, are you going to make something truly worthwhile, or is there another better way to achieve that end goal that is going to produce a better experience for that end user? So I think it's a big one, and we're definitely going to get right into it in that Pioneer session.
Nice, love it. Carlos has got two questions. Carlos, why don't you unmute?
Do it.
Ask live.
Sure. Anna, very nice to meet you, and thanks for sharing. So I'll start with the easy one, so, which is best AR experience you have ever played with?
Played with or designed?
Played with. So this is you actually played with it or used it. Gosh. I play with everything, so that's why I say played.
God, that's a tricky one. I feel like there's been so many that I've...
All right, one of the good ones.
God. Put on the spot, I can't think of any.
I'll give you a way out, maybe.
Thank
or
you.
Do you want to share the best use of AR? So something that you've been like, oh, wow, that was an incredible use of AR.
What the other?
Probably, probably the ones that I've found is, you know, the IKEA ones where they allow like you to arrange. I love interior design. So it's a bit of a, and the ones where actually, yes, now I can think of them now, like where you can put paint color on the wall. Like, you know, those ones where, and again, it comes back to fully interacting with the exact room you're in. And so, you know, being able to just move things around and decide, yeah, that works, that doesn't, without actually going to IKEA, building something, then having to return it is, yeah, that's my answer. Thank you awesome. For the way
Thank
out.
You.
But I agree with that. I mean, and I think that's, you know, to that question we had at the start, which was about, you know, what's changed over the period and over the last 10 years. And you know, I think we've talked about this on State of AR before, which is that movement from toy to tool and that sort of sense of utility and where AR can actually really be, you know, a kind of net positive in terms of sort of efficiency and understanding and, you know, and helping sort of problem solve things. And I think some of those ones, they might not sound the sexiest, but they are really, really useful. I mean, you know, Carlos, I remember actually, you know, what another one that I always loved, and you know this one, is the work we did with Little's Pet Shop with Hasbro, which, again, it's not something massive, but there was, and so this was the Littlest Pet Shop toys. It was quite actually more of a sort of manufacturing and technical challenge, wasn't it? Because we had to create these custom codes that could exist on, you know, the curved surface of, you know, different colored small pets that had to be able to be produced, manufactured at line speed and still scan, all that sort of good stuff. And then within the Littlest Pet Shop app, you know, because there are collectibles, when you scan them in, it would bring a little animation, you know, of that pet to life and give you a bit more of a backstory to it. And it was like, you know, then it sort of added, you know, extra points into your sort of digital experience. Kind of simple. I mean, nothing too crazy about it, but it's just you know, was that kind of 1+1=3 element to it, which is you could still enjoy the physical thing without the digital bit, but the digital thing just added another kind of cool way to share and sort of you know, get things with friends. So I think there's something really, again, it's coming back to that sort of small thing. I personally am also a really big fan of the stuff that we've done recently with Legoland as well. I think, you know, again, you know, something like Mythica, the IP, the story behind that IP is all about a portal between, you know, kind of the Lego bricks to this other fantasy world, and AR helps, you know, take you through that vortices to it. So I think it's that thing of where, you know, where it just sort of feels like you are connecting the dots, you know, through this kind of burst of energy, which is kind of what AR I think provides from physical to digital. That's where I think it's really exciting.
Love it. Eric's got a question for you, Anna, which is quite specific and related to the Kennedy Center.
Look what Eric's got behind him on his wall. I recognize that.
I know, yeah, Anna. I do. Lovely.
It's great to see you.
You too.
I'm delighted to be here. Yeah. And the tour is going strong still. It's amazing. Incredible. Like the fact that, yeah, exactly, it's survived through all these years, yeah. But still going well. Really, really wonderful. Just talked to somebody the other day who said, a volunteer here who said, I just gave out another certificate to a kid who was so excited with their family walking around. So it's still amazing. I guess my question really, other than just wanting to say hello to you, is whether having done a specific project like that, and it can actually even maybe relate to more general projects, what lessons have you learned? What would you go back and do differently, you know, kind of from what you've experienced with AR? Are there things that come to you with our specific project, which is definitely a terrestrial thing that also then became a web AR thing, but like, it doesn't have to be about our specific project. I'm just sort of more interested in like, what have you learned over time? What are some of maybe like the biggest things you've learned? Like, oh, I wish that I had known that then and I would go back and do it differently.
I think probably the biggest thing, which it's taken me a long time to understand, it's quite specific, but when you animate or make something move on a screen, that's all you're seeing is that movement. So it's quite, you know, exaggerated. But when you suddenly add in the movement of someone's phone and the kind of the movement that you already have, if you create any experience that has just subtle animations in it, it just gets completely lost. Like you just don't really see it. So you kind of have to exaggerate everything, especially movement wise and kind of animation. So yeah, that would probably be the biggest thing that I would have learned. Probably took me about 5 years to figure that out, to be honest.
but I should say, sorry to add as well, because I think there should be some context to the work that we've done with Eric, you know, for the John F. Kennedy Center of Performing Arts, which was, again, it was a brilliant brief, because they had an artist in residence, Mo Willems, sort of famous sort of illustrator and book writer, who has this dastardly pigeon who is he's a mean guy. And the idea was to bring this character into the center, with the launch of a new area called the Reach, and see how we could create these sort of, I guess, family experiences, sort of guided tours. So when you're with the family, there's something for the kids to do as well. And so we had these plaques where the pigeon you'll see here. Ah, there's the pigeon would come to life, and you'd have to find these plaques around. And actually, he's sort of playing this terribly sort of naughty role as your guide, and sort of telling you these fake stories about the things that are there. And you've got to decide whether he's telling the truth or not. And as you do, you sort of collect cookies. And at the end, if you've got enough cookies, you get a certificate. And again, a really lovely way of trying to, and a very collaborative process of going, well, where do we put them? What are the stories? How do we work with Mo and his illustrator to bring, you know, the essence of that, of the pigeon to life, which was, you know, quite a task, because very particular about mouth movement and eyes and, you know, kind of all these sorts of things. And Mo did a wonderful voiceover to it as well. And it's been, really, really well received. But another one where, so important to think about that context and, you know, where we were placing these plinths and what did that mean for the flow of, you know, other people around the space. And, you know, how far is too far and how many is too many, and you know, how long is too long for the experiences. Yeah. There's so many things, you know, to
and it was great. I mean, it was beneficial for that project that we actually got to do a site visit before, so we actually got blown out to Washington DC, which I think should be in every project. You should, if it's in a different country, we should get to go there. So we had a whirlwind visit and actually got to see the space and kind of think, oh, this would be the best place for it. This, you know, is this experience going to work in this room? Should it be in a different? So yeah, it was really great to do that.
Yeah, critical.
Nice. We've got a couple more questions. Okay. Atlas has asked, do you find yourself animating within Studio more or using a third-party software?
So I love animating in Studio just because you can create the depth. So although, like, Adobe After Effects, yes, it's a more professional, like, you can do a lot more animation in there. But to then put that into an AR experience, it has to be, you know, sent out as an alpha video, which is all flat. So that then has to be put into the experience. So you can, you know, you could do, I mean, it's a perfectly good way of doing it. So you could export an After Effects alpha video and put it in and then have maybe a few of them. But I just love the freedom of actually animating directly into a studio. If it's a really complicated animation, then yes, After Effects is the way to go and export it. But anything that you can kind of do quite simply I recommend Studio. And it's very easy to get to grips with because it's you know, it's a lot simpler. Like After Effects is ridiculous. There's so much to learn. But actually Studios, once you get the hang of the basics, there's a lot you can do with it.
Love it. Great answer. Maybe this is one for after State of AR Live. Mike Myers is asking, any good examples of AR used in learning and development? We've been searching for the best way to include it in our course designs. We have found a few ways, but always looking for inspiration.
What age group are we talking here? Because we've done quite a bit around STEM and sort of, I guess, K-12. But it's and indeed some stuff that's more around kind of higher education and vocational learning. So I guess there is a bit of where's it? What's your sweet spot?
Yeah, thank you. And this has been really great. So yeah, we work in the international development space with adults.
Okay.
So this is for adults.
Well, so we've done TAFE, who are in New South Wales in Australia. They do. They've really been properly at the forefront of how to use, you know, I guess immersive technologies in higher education. And so they've been doing things and very dependent on, I guess, what that topic is. So we've done stuff that's more in their, I guess, their medical and sort of optical sort of lanes for certain things about, you know, how you could do exploded eyeballs in AR in order to understand the construct although God, Dave, you're right on it, the construct of of the eye, and use that as a way to understand the terminology of the different ones, and then set that up to have some sort of, you know, almost quiz at the end so that you could sort of test yourself on having understood what those different functions do and sort of stepping through that. So I think, you know, I think for some of those things of, you know, how you can just take a subject and sort of begin to deconstruct things, you know, tends to work quite well in AR. Not surprisingly, that sort of exploded view piece is sort of interesting. We were speaking to someone, I've never got to do it, of doing the same with anatomy, you know, so how you could take a dog, for instance, and just strip away, you know, look at the muscular structure, look at the skeletal structure, look at all those different things and begin to sort of understand those different elements. Because again, I think when you get to that thing of anything that you can sort of place on a floor or tabletop and begin to sort of navigate around and sort of see become, I think, you know, really compelling and good use case that just works a bit better than just sort of flat textbook.
We can definitely send some examples across as well, Mike. We'd have your email after the session.
Very good. Dave, does this leave us to get to our cushion cliche?
Yeah.
Are we at that stage? Have we got there? have we sunk that low already? I think this one's quite a good one. I mean, I don't know. I'm not the judge of these anymore. We've got know your XYZs. or Zs, depending on where you are in the world. So, you know, I guess much like your ABCs, you know, these are kind of the building blocks of good design in AR, a bit like, as Anna said, it's that sort of, you know, you've got to consider the spatial nature of that kind of narrative and how it's going to play out in the Z axis, you know, because, you know, we can do some really wonderful things with parallax and sort of depth of field and I guess that all important relationship between the content and its environment. And so I think, you know, thinking more in that sort of way is the way forward. And what I think is going to end up once these cushions go on sale, being one of the more popular ones. I mean, we're starting from an incredibly low base. I mean, this might get, I don't know, this might get 2 sales, 3 sales. so that's where we are. So that's it. So next week, we're going to go to someone completely different. We're actually going to get Eden, who is leads our QA team, on to the show. And QA, I mean, I liken QA to sort of the sort of script writers in Hollywood. They never get the accolades they deserve. And frankly, without them, you can get some really poor quality output. And I think it's the same, it's true of QA. QA is not just a thing that happens in the last 24 hours before you put something out and you just hope that you know it sails through. It's something that actually really has to be involved in the process throughout, and it makes for better experiences. And there's quite a lot of nuance to it when it comes to AR. So, and you know, Eden's again, another wonderful chap who's been at Zappar for a very long time. And I almost defy, I'd like to meet anybody else who has QA'd as many AR experiences as he has in his years of doing the job. So he's got lots of war stories, let's say. So that should be fun. I've also, you know, a plug for the fact that we are now just 2 weeks away from our second annual AR Pioneer Summit on the 8th and 9th of November. I think I might have mentioned this in the last show. And it's kind of just 2 days, really, to not only hear about, I guess, the latest and greatest from Zappar, which we tend to do at those sessions, but also learn, I guess, from our expert panelists. And there'll be sort of clients and agency partners, and just an opportunity to learn more about, I guess, the tools and how to build and deploy sort of the best AR on the planet. So I would definitely say don't miss that. Spaces are limited and it is filling up fast, so don't delay. I do think it's one for everyone. You know, I mean, you know, clearly friends, colleagues, family, grandparents, grandkids, grandchildren. I mean, they're the future, right? You better have the grandkids on there because, you know, they'll all be using this stuff. So I would head over to www.zappar.com/AR-pioneers. Very catchy little number that. I'm sure we can set that to song at some point. I'd register now. And of course, this episode will be available as of this Friday on the streaming service of your choice. So you can look back, reminisce, enjoy these good times that we're experiencing now. The warm embrace of Wednesday afternoon could come flooding back on a Friday morning. I mean, it's a lovely thing. So that's it for this week. Have a great week ahead. Thanks, everyone.